much. I'm going to go a little bit more in depth before I start kind of what I do with Play. What do I do for the company? I was hired on about a year ago. And prior to that, many of you know probably Coach Ron McKeefery. He got brought on with the company about a year and a half ago. And really to branch out our the student athlete division of what we do. In Woodstock, Georgia, we have our headquarters, which is all of our sports performance born. But we do have a performance facility. It's called Play Hard. And up until Coach Mack and I getting brought on, it was just adult. It was just an adult training facility. But the purpose behind the training facility is that we wanted to bring science-based programming to the adult population because it really doesn't exist. So Coach Mack and I, we got brought on to really build out the student-athlete side of things. So kind of what we do, it's not just about the performance facility, but we really pour into three buckets. The first bucket is being ambassadors for the company. So we have the opportunity to go to clinics like this. We go out, we're creating relationships, right? It's all about creating relationships in this profession. It's not just about the X's and O's. So Coach McKeefery and I, we get to travel all over the world. We get to go to clinics, conferences. We don't tend to actually sit at the booth all the time, like our sales reps do to sell product, but we actually infiltrate ourselves into the crowd, like I said, to build relationships and get to know all of you guys out there. So our second bucket that we pour into, we are educators. So again, we get to go to clinics, conferences, we get to present. I'm up here today, a passion of mine is to give back and to teach our younger generation, but my older veteran coaches out there, I promise you're gonna hopefully get at least one or two takeaways from what I'm talking about today. But Coach McKeefery also has his podcast, he has his TV show called Beyond the Chalk, so if you guys haven't actually checked those out, our very own University of Texas Coach Mabe has been featured in one of those TV shows, and they're just phenomenal. It's all really about featuring coaches around the world, what their story is, why they're here, and it really deep dives into the support system that we really need to be successful in this industry, and that's really the family aspect, whether that's your work family or your at-home family. These TV episodes really expose just the story of multiple coaches. So that's really cool. And then the third bucket is, of course, for coaches. Like I talked about, our performance facility in Woodstock, we're going to be building a performance institute probably in the next 6 months, and we're expanding right now. We're in a small 3,000 square foot facility. We're going to be expanding into a 10,000 square foot facility. There we get to coach athletes. We try not to go younger than 9, but we do have a few 8-year-olds, and then we're training, like I said, all the way up into 65-plus-year-old grandmas and all the way up there. But I get to train combine athletes as well, and I just finished helping a U.S. women's soccer player return to the field. So it's one of those things where, being a collegiate strength coach, I'm so focused on the 17 to 22-year-old, and it's really made me a better coach now that I have to really simplify my coaching and my programming to fit a 9-year-old's brain, or even an older athlete's brain that might have been in it for a while and they're stuck in their ways. So it's really cool. I challenge you to kind of, when you do have off time or you have a chance to go volunteer or observe another coach, try to pick a different age group than what you're used to. And you'd be surprised how much you actually learn from observing a different age group or maybe a different type of programming. So that's a little bit about who I am, what we do. I also forgot to mention the education side of things. We put on labs and X-Labs, and we are kicking off our season in Australia. So we actually get to travel internationally and put on educational events just like this one. So if you're ever in any of the states or the countries that we're putting on our labs or X-Labs, don't hesitate to reach out to me. My contacts will be at the end of the presentation. I'd love to get to know you more and see how we can make it possible to wherever you are or get you to actually get involved with our events. So again, that's a little bit of what we do. I want to say big thanks to University of Texas Athletic Performance staff, especially Coach Mabe, Coach Abney, and Coach Craig. I've known those guys for a couple of years now, and it's kind of cool seeing them develop as coaches and as a staff, and now here I am at their home, in their hometown, first time in Austin, so far it's been really cool. Been to a couple other cities in Texas, but this is always one of the ones that everyone's like, you got to see Austin, you got to go to UT, so it's very cool being here today. I also want to thank my Clay family. I have Jet Thompson and Mike Ortiz, who's going to be at our booth today. They're our sales reps for this region. These guys are just supporting me, being there for me. And then, of course, my Clay family at home. I have a co-director who really takes care of all the adult training. We also have our two assistants. And, of course Coach Mac, he's been really created a ton of opportunities for me as a coach and really for this profession, but also thanks to my staff at home that really keeps me sane on a day-to-day basis, because even though I seem mild-mannered up here, I'm actually kind of crazy, but aren't we all? So, that my staff at home, I mean, they're awesome. We have fun every day when we're at work, and we tend to try to keep it light, but I'll talk a little bit more about that as we go through. Today's objectives, I think this is important to kind of create, that wide perspective of what we're going to talk about. I'm going to challenge you, older strength coaches out there, what your philosophy are, what are your principles that support your philosophy. I'm going to go ahead and tell you a story, and then from that story, I'll be able to pull how I came up with the 9 pillars of influence. So my coaching principles, I kind of go back and forth philosophy, obviously, is just your thought, but your principles are really what's going to bring your thoughts to life. So my coaching principles, it's very simple. It's creating professional friendships. So if you can think about the strongest friendships that you have in your life, all right, any kind of friendship, it could be with your spouse, significant other, your colleagues, maybe your children, all right, your best friends. There's two things that support all friendships or really make friendships what they are, and that's trust and honesty. Right, you can't have any type of friendship without trusting that individual, without them trusting you, you being honest with that individual, or them being honest with you. Trust and honesty is the basis of all friendships. So now, let's bring this into a professional setting. Let's call it professional friendships. In the collegiate sector, you have your support staff. You're part of the support staff. That's collegiate, high school, or even private sector. So I listed a couple up there. I'll just run through them. We have our athletic trainers, academic advisors, our nutritionists. Maybe if you're in the private sector, you have your parents. They're part of the support system. Maybe the high school coaches. Either way, no matter what situation you're in, you also have your administrators. So how are you creating professional friendships with these people, with with the support staff, to in turn to better serve your athlete? And I'm gonna get into detail with that, but think about the type of people that are outside of the weight room that can impact the athlete's life and start creating better relationships with them. It's gonna in turn make it easier for you as a coach. On the flip side of that is also professional friendships with our athletes. Now it might be kind of weird, oh, I don't wanna be friends with my athlete, but when all is said and done, we are not the parent and we are not the head coach. So what that leaves us is being the fun aunt or uncle, usually. So you get to actually have a different kind of relationship with these student athletes. So again, you are kind of a friend to them. Again, let's put professional in front of that to make it right? You are a professional friend to the student athlete. So go back to the two principles of friendship, trust and honesty. Can you trust your athlete? Can you trust your athlete when you turn their back? Can you trust them to do the right thing? Are they trusting your program, what you're doing, what you're providing for them? And then honesty, are you being honest with your athlete, or are you being a disservice and you're not telling them like it is? And likewise, are they being honest with you? Are they actually telling you what they're going through, whether good or bad? Again, I will go into detail with this thing, with those. So the story I'm gonna tell you is about a student athlete. Student-athlete's journey through their undergrad 4 years of college. So the student-athlete went to a camp prior to their first season, and they had a chance to meet their strength coach for the first time. Well, their first impression was everything, right? They had to stand tall, they had to have a good handshake, but they were nervous. They didn't know what to expect. They've never been part of a sound strength. program. Obviously, high school going to college, it was very different. Well, in the freshman year, this athlete experienced, the strength coach during the summer actually made time for this athlete. And after meeting them at the camp, the strength coach opened up the weight room and they allowed this athlete to train over the summer prior to starting their freshman year to get a head start. So this athlete then went into their freshman year and they endured some injuries, right? It happens sometimes. And the strength coach was really attentive to this athlete, made sure that they made modifications for this athlete, made sure this athlete was never ostracized from the group, always kept them involved during their injuries. During this athlete's sophomore year, they went on and the strength coach actually, instead of keeping them with an upperclassman, the strength coach actually gave this athlete freshmen to work with. Now, this strength coach was instilling some trust in this athlete. As this athlete went on during their junior year, they were having some nutrition struggles. So they looked to their strength coach, and the strength coach provided honesty, right? Let's sit down, let's break down what you're eating, what kind of calories are you eating, are they positive calories, are they negative calories? So the strength coach was very honest to this athlete. During the athlete's senior year, they went on and they realized that maybe strength and conditioning is something they wanted to give a shot at. So they became the intern, and now this athlete, instead of having accountability to just themselves or maybe their teammates, they started having accountability for everyone else that was in the weight room. They were one of the strength interns. So having this accountability and having this experience, this athlete went on and graduated college and was staying in touch with their strength coach. And the strength coach offered this student athlete an opportunity to come back to be a graduate assistant at their alma mater. So they went back, they took advantage of this opportunity, and clearly the strength coach and the strength staff had an impact on this athlete. Well, when all was said and done, this athlete was the legacy of this strength coach. And I tell you that because this athlete was me, and it was my experience that I very quickly walked you through, but there's a point to everything. So, the nine pillars of influence. You don't have to write this down, I'm gonna go through slide by slide, but I talked about it. First impression, making time for your athlete, attentiveness, trust, honesty, back to my principles, all right? Accountability, giving your athletes opportunity, having an impact on their lives, not just in the weight room, and then eventually leaving your legacy behind. So the first thing, first impression, The Rock, right? What a first impression. All right, imagine meeting The Rock in person for the first time. The most beautiful. I mean, I don't know about you guys, but I think I stopped in my tracks and just kind of like lose words. So first impression, when I met my strength coach for the first time, now this guy, I was smaller than I was right now, but I was meeting an ex-offensive lineman from the Big Ten level. He was a massive dude. He didn't have bald head and a beard, but he had a beard. All right, but he was a big dude. And I had to stand up in front of him, give him a firm handshake, and let him know who I was. I was this literal, just graduated senior going into my freshman year, but it was important. How are you making your first impression on your athletes as a strength coach? Now, at the collegiate level, I absolutely love scaring the crap out of my student athletes for the first time. Why? Because it kind of gets them to know that I'm serious. All right, I'm not joking around. We're here to get better. It's about standards and expectations, but what are you doing? So I make sure that I lay it all on the line. My first impression with my student athletes, whether I have them after 4 years, I still want to remind them, hey, when you walk into the weight room, it's time to work. We're gonna have fun, but you need to focus and you have to give forth your best effort prior to that fun actually arriving. So again, what's your first impression gonna be like with these student athletes? Moving on, making time. So I talked about how, I met my strength coach for the first time, and I had a whole summer prior to the start of preseason. Well, my strength coach made time for me in the weight room. I got to lift with a junior on my team, and I got to get a head start to preseason. So how are you making time? Even prior to these kids joining your program, how are you making time for them? What are you doing above and beyond? Now, I understand that the summertime is a time for us to actually relax a little bit. If we're in the academic, if we're in the high school collegiate setting, private sector is a little different. But summertime, time is when you actually can kind of take a deep breath, and you don't have to be in the office or the weight room for 12 hours out of the day. But what are you doing on the front end to set up for these student athletes when they first show up? So it's a simple, when I was at Rutgers, they had a Bridge the Gap program. So we actually allowed students that could come in and they got to train with us prior to the start of their freshman year because they had to take some credits. Again, we were able to make time for incoming athletes to show them the ropes to get a head start on what they were trying to accomplish or prior to preseason, prior to their first season. What can you do, maybe if you don't have a Bridge the Gap program? Write an incoming freshman program. Give it to your head coach. Go down the hall and sit with your head coach. Walk them through it. Obviously, it can be super basic. Four sets of 10 on squat. 4 sets of 10 on pull-ups. 4 sets of 10 on push-ups. All GPP. It can be super, super simple. It can be body weight. But when you show up and you go back and you're in that meeting for the first time and you're making that first impression and you bring up the fact that you sent out that incoming freshman program and you said, hey, I expect you guys to be ready. I gave you the first step to be successful. Now all of a sudden they're going to be like, wow, they're serious. They do have my back. They already put themselves out there to get me better, even prior to starting to coach them. So think about that. How can you make time for your athlete even prior to them officially being in your program? Now, just like I had never done formal goalkeeping training, I had never had formal strength training, I never had been through a 2-hour practice. So I endured some injuries as a freshman. Injuries, they're going to plague our athletes. It happens. Obviously, we hope that we're doing the best job that we can, that they're preparing themselves to do the best job when they're in the weight room or they're on the field. Be attentive. Be attentive to every single one of your athletes. You should live and die by this quote. People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. It's so true. Through and through. Through and through. People don't care how much you know unless they know how much you care. Injured athletes is a perfect example. If you have an injured athlete and they are coming with the team, they can have one working limb and you can still keep them involved. You can still keep them involved. They can do core, they can do grip, you can do one-arm band pulls, pushes, whatever the case is. Keep them involved. Now I understand that some kids come back from injuries and they might have an ACL injury. They might be on crutches, but they can't really do anything. Still get them involved. Be creative. Put them in charge of the app station. Put them in charge of collecting all the equipment, but give them a role. By doing that, when that athlete gets healthy, I guarantee you, without a doubt, that they're going to have your back. And they're going to buy into your program that much faster. Why? Because you were there for them at the lowest part of their career. And that was being injured, and that was probably thinking that they felt that they were homeless. All right? Be there for your athletes. Make sure that you're attentive, even when they're injured. That's when you have to be there the most. Go down to the athletic trainer. Go see them at the rehab facility. See how they're progressing. It will make such a huge impact. Such a huge impact when they now have to work for you and they're back full time and they're back on that playing surface. They're going to buy in and they're going to get other kids to buy in. So they're going to start infiltrating the minds of the other teammates and say, no, that coach does know what they're talking about. They do have your back. They do care about you. Now I know we're in Big 12 country. And I know this is a rival, but we're going to talk about trust. This is Matt Campbell, who's the head coach at Iowa State. Now, they beat TCU, and this is where I got the quote from, so my Texas fans out there, I'm sure you're happy about that. But after the big win against TCU, the cameras followed Matt Campbell, the team, back into the locker room, and they got everything on camera, and he started talking to the team. And the biggest thing that he said, and it resonated, it was so powerful. And I have it up there, it says, if you fall in love with the process, eventually, the process will love you back. But the sick part about it is that you never know when the process is gonna love you back. You never know. So you gotta keep on grinding. You gotta show up every day. You gotta give forth your best effort day in and day out, because you never know when the process is actually gonna love you back. So how does this relate to a coach? How does it relate to how we give back to our athletes? Explain to them the why. Show them the why. Get them to trust in you, not only, oh, this is gonna get you better, this is why we're doing PowerClean. No, explain to them that triple extension has everything to do with being a powerful runner. Explain to them the detail of things. I was training this athlete right now. He's either a sophomore or junior in high school. He's a little cross athlete. And after 2 weeks training with us, coach, when are we gonna hang? When are we gonna hang? I wanna hang clean. And I'm like, back it up. You gotta get better at your power strokes. You gotta get better at your pulls. It's not just gonna happen overnight. And time and time again, every time he came in, relax, it'll come. 8 to 10 weeks later, we finally introduced hang clean. But all of a sudden, now, I'm not gonna say he's absolutely pristine, the best Olympic lifter I've ever seen, but now it becomes a realization that there is a reason behind it all. And there is a reason why I kept on pushing back him, slow down, relax, there's a reason. And now every time he comes in, he's still excited to do hang clean, but if I didn't show him that there was a process to it and that it doesn't happen overnight, he could have gotten hurt. He would have been sitting out for the spring season. So again, figure out a way to get your athletes to trust you. Figure out a way for you to trust your athletes. A way that you also can do this is by going out to the playing surface, going out to practice, showing up at games. What's an easier way to get a kid to buy in when you're actually at practice? You're actually somewhere outside of the weight room. All of a sudden they see you, and I remember as an athlete, we could not wait to see our strength coach. Now he was a football strength coach, but he also had women's soccer. So of course he did everything football, but when he showed up at one of our competitions, it was the best thing ever. And of course we made him feel super awkward because he was finally at one of our competitions. But it made a difference. It was almost like a reset button. We showed up in the weight room and we were that much more excited to train the next day because he was at one of our games. But it's not just about showing your face, it's about being there. And not just being there, but listening, taking notes, listening to the verbiage of the coach, to the athletic trainer. What kind of drills are they going through? What kind of things are they doing in the game? Listen to the coach, learning the verbiage, taking that and bringing it into the weight room. And you're gonna start seeing light bulbs go off. Because you're gonna say, hey, remember when you did this in the game, or remember that drill, how you're working on this, these mechanics? Well, these are the exercises that are gonna get you better at the mechanics so that you can go and accomplish this on competition day. So again, everything ties in. It goes back, professional friendships with the head coach, with the assistant coaches, with the athletic trainers. Go out and show that you're invested, not only when you're in the weight room, but you're invested in these kids' lives outside of the weight room. If you're in a private sector, go to their games. Don't call up the head coach, hey, I'm training Susie, I'm training Sally, can I come to a practice? I just want to observe, I just want to see what you guys go through. It makes such a huge difference when that kid comes back in and they're ready to train for you. And now you can talk, oh, I saw you out there, and all of a sudden they get a little, your chest gets a little prouder. Right, they're walking around, they got a little swag all of a sudden, because you gave it to them. You showed them that, hey, I see what you're doing out there. It makes a difference. Honesty. Again, I talked about, we've all been there. We don't know what proper nutrition is from the get-go. We don't know what that is. I'll never forget, I was listening to Adam Veit present, I think it was at an NSCA conference a couple years ago, and he talked about his athletes showed up, they went to the training session, and at the end of the training session he said, okay guys, now I want you to eat some carbs and protein right now. We just worked hard, we got to replace the calories, we got to get nutrition back to our bodies. Can car. A bagel. Yes, awesome. Bagels. The car. Now, what about a protein? Ooh, ooh, ooh. Go ahead. Cream cheese. Cream cheese. This kid said cream cheese. And this is an exact example that Adam and I gave. Now, this was like a senior in high school. Now, hey, sure. Really good. You don't get a lot of protein from cream cheese. But again, these kids don't know. I sat in my strength coach's office and I was like, I don't know what I'm doing wrong. I'm gaining negative weight during the season. Now, what am I supposed to do? I was like, well, what are you eating for lunch? Slice of pizza and a cookie. And he's like, yeah, we gotta stop that. But it's about honesty. He's being honest. He might have known the answer already, but he was challenging me. Am I going to be honest with him? Am I actually going to tell him the truth? Now, it's important. We're in a role, we're in a position to be really blunt. We have to tell it like it is. Now, again, you have to know your audience. You don't have to be a jerk about it, but you have to tell it like it is. You can't just beat around the bush. You got to be honest. And you got to make sure that your athletes learn to be honest as well. So in a coaching standpoint, you need to step back. And if someone's spotting their teammate, ask them, was that squat really 90 degrees? Well, why'd you count the rep? Or better yet, was that? I mean, you could take it as a talk to the athlete. Are you really coachable? Or are you making excuses all the time? Challenge the athlete on honesty. You can know the answer again. You can know the answer before they give you the answer. But challenge them. Challenge them. Give it an opportunity to be honest to you. One of my biggest pet peeves as a coach is athletes motivating each other when it's not to the standard and expectation that we have. Something as simple as warm-up. Right? You do walking lunges in a warm-up. A kid doesn't get their knee all the way down, but their teammate's like, yeah, that's a great lunge. Get it. No, you have to stop it right then and there. Say, is that to our standard expectation? His knee is 6 inches from the ground. No, that is not a proper lunge. No, that is not pass. No, that is not to our standard expectation. Again, know your audience, but you have to be honest with your kids. Otherwise, they're going to try to get through life with this, like, this phase, with this, like, fog over their eyes, thinking that they can get away with it. Again, know your audience, but you have to tell it like it is. You have to be honest with your student athletes. Accountability. Again, I had a chance to be an intern as an undergrad. So accountability, it was something that was brought to me earlier than what I expected. I had accountability to make sure that not only I was doing the right thing, that my teammates were doing the right thing, but now I was working with multiple teams in the weight room. As an intern, as any intern GA's first year assistants? Okay, we have a couple. And guys, be proud. Raise your hand. Like, we've all been there. They're a little nervous back there. Like, yeah, we've all been there. We've all been first years. We've all been second years. It's fine. Be proud. When you raise your hand high, that means that more people actually know, and they're going to want to come talk to you and shed their wisdom on you. All right? But first year, second year guys, it is so important to stick to your standard and expectations. All right? I talked about it prior to this slide. It's so important to stick to your standard expectation. We all have our favorite athletes. We all have our favorite athletes that we tend to get along with them better. You know, we can like dab them up a little bit, you know, but we all got them. But we can't make excuses or let them get away with the little things when we don't let the non-compliant athletes get away from things. We don't let the kids that have terrible technique get away with things. So why would we let the cool athlete that we all get along with, why would we let them get away with anything? So recheck yourself. I struggle with that starting off. I have no problem being vulnerable and telling everybody that. Now sometimes I made excuses with the good athletes. I'm like, oh, well, they'll get it. They're good enough to be on the field, so
like maybe cutting a rep here and there. You can't be like that. Hold yourself accountable to your own standard and expectations, and I guarantee you that climbing the ladder to where you want to be in this profession is going to happen faster because you stuck with your MO. You didn't steer off your path of the standard expectation of holding yourself accountable to your program and what you're trying to accomplish. Opportunity, it's one of my favorite pictures. I didn't take it, but these were my one of my teams, one of my senior classes at Rutgers, and this was on graduation day. It's all about opportunity. What are you doing for your student athletes, for your athletes, to prepare them for what's to come after? For what's to come when they graduate? For what's to come after they leave your facility or leave high school or leave college? What are you doing to create opportunity for them? Who you know is what's going to get you in the door, but what you know is what's going to keep you there. Help them out, get them in the door, but make sure that they're prepared and they know what to do to stay there. Again, I'm going to go back to my principles. Professional friendships, trust and honesty, knowing who your who the academic advisor are, who the nutritionists are, maybe the career services in private sector in high school. Who are their, what's their favorite subject? Can they do an after school program with the art teacher or the music teacher or whatever the case is? Are you getting to know your student athletes outside of the weight room to create them better opportunity once they leave your nest? Again, what are you doing for them? How are you setting them up for a successful future? The impact, my favorite. Having impact on young minds. You can make a difference. You can make a difference no matter what, but it's how you choose to make that difference. Obviously, I'm standing up here because my undergraduate strength coaches made an impact on my life. Like, they made this profession real for me. They made this profession real for me. I didn't know that I could be a strength coach. But not every one of your athletes is going to be a strength coach. So figure out how can you impact them, just on a day-to-day basis. And this is the aha moments that we talk about. Now, the aha moments, it doesn't always have to be like grinding it up and getting your 1RM on squat. It doesn't have to be hitting like that low 40 time. I have a girl up there, the lacrosse player. I did speed school with my Rutgers lacrosse team once a week. Only schedule only allowed once a week. I know, not ideal, but once a week I would do speed school with these girls. And I said, the biggest thing that's going to make a difference is when you're at home, in your dorm, or you're at your house, and you need a study break, or maybe there's a commercial on TV, stand up and practice your speed skaters. Stand up and practice your arm action. And all those little times when you're not with me is gonna make a difference back when you're with me, because you're gonna be that much further ahead than the rest of your teams. Well, this freshman lacrosse player took me seriously. And she's, of course, that type A that gets in. She's watching film with her coaches. And she's like, whoa, wait, stop it. Takes a screenshot, sends it to me. Hey, coach, check it out. Check out my arm action. You see that positive shin angle? That girl's trailing me, that's right. But all of a sudden, you're like, all right. Like, it's making sense. That's an aha moment. That's the reason why I'm up here, and I love to do what I do. It's something as simple as arm action. Again, we're all a little crazy. That stuff makes me excited to show up every day. When a student athlete can realize something as simple as working on arm action or positive shin angle to beat out her opponent, and then her realizing the impact that it makes on her performance on the field. It's crazy. The middle picture are my little munchkins, 9-year-old football players. excuse me. I trained them over the entire summer at Play Park, and I got a chance, so happened that they had a hell of a game and they crushed their opponent. But when they saw me on the sideline, they couldn't wait to take a picture with Coach B. And it was such a special moment. At 9 years old, these kids understood that. They saw that I didn't have to go to a game. I didn't have to go cheer and run up. And it's so funny. I don't know. Now, I'm originally from the Northeast, so Friday Night Lights and Pee Wee football, like, I didn't get it until I moved down here about a year ago. And I really got it in starting in August. But when you're at these games, parents, like, run up and down the sideline as the plays are going. They don't stay. They don't, like, sit in the stands. So here I am. All of a sudden, I'm like, oh, we got to go. We're cheering them on. But these kids saw that. They saw that I was involved. They saw that I was enjoying myself watching them compete, making an impact. We got off, finished the game, it was a victory, and they snapped a picture. I'm like, what do you guys want to do? Like, put up the guns. Like, that wasn't my idea to post like that, but that's what they wanted to do. Again, what's the kind of impact? It's an aha moment. What kind of aha moments are you creating in your kids' lives? The picture on the, I guess, all the way to your right, I'm looking at it backwards, but you know, it's my right too, is one of our, again, the younger student athlete that we work with. He's about 12 years old, and when we start our sessions, and there's always a new face in there, we literally do an icebreaker. We stand in a circle, and we say, okay, introduce yourself, say what school you go to, and the sports that you play. Because being in the private sector, you're working with multiple schools, multiple counties. People are coming up from all over the place. And this kid stands up and it's like, he introduces himself. He says where he's from. And he's like, and my sports are fishing and archery. And I like to play basketball and this just for fun. And I'm like, what? Archery? Like, you like to shoot things? And he's like, yeah, absolutely. This kid only plays basketball for fun. Freak athlete. Like that kid where you're like, why aren't you doing something else than just archery? But hey, it's his niche. He loves to do it. I'm going to support him. This kid, if he could, he would train with us every single day. But I have to obviously slow him down, say no, we need to recover. You can't be here every day. But what kind of impact are we having? Here he is, just a short story with him. He came home from school one day, and his mom's like, how's school? How is everything? He's just like, it was okay. He's like, what's wrong? He's like, it's so cold in school that I couldn't take my sweatshirt off. I couldn't show all my friends my new t-shirt. Guess what t-shirt that was? It was a play t-shirt. Like, how cool is that? Like, this kid is bummed because he didn't flash his, like, new play t-shirt to all his friends at school. Again, it's an impact. Now, he's in school. I took this off his Instagram. But he's in school and he's doodling. Work hard. Play harder. Like, talk about getting a kid to buy in at the age of 12 and really understanding what it takes to work hard, give forth your best effort, and see a difference. So it's so cool. Your aha moments don't have to be that bench PR. It doesn't have to be that highest vertical jump you've ever hit. It can be something as simple as this, making a difference in these kids' lives. Why do I coach? I coach because of the kids and the passion I have for the game and the sport itself. There's no better feeling than to teach than teaching a child the importance of discipline, hard work, team effort, dedication, determination, and the heart it takes not only in life, not only in sports, but in life. So I saw this quote years ago, printed it out, laminated it, and it's just a friendly reminder for myself. And you can take it with what it is, all right? You might have a different why, but at the end of the day, it's not just about sport, it's about life. And we have to make an impact in these kids' lives, even beyond the sport. We're all about the process, all right? We're all about developing young minds. That's why we're in this profession. It's about giving back. It's about servicing them. How can we serve them better? So the pictures I have up there, yes,
Believe it or not, this is Jen's son, the football, the skinny football kid. But I had a chance to, I trained them over the summer, and I had a chance to go to one of their games. And again, they're excited. They see Coach B down on the field with them. They want to take pictures, all right? They saw me outside of the weight room, outside of our training facility, supporting them, doing what they love. The middle picture is my field hockey team at Rutgers. These girls, I don't know if there's any of y'all have, they coach field hockey out there, but they're a goofy bunch. I don't know if that's a culture.
Yeah, I love it. They are a goofy bunch. It's like, they always go to the beat of their own drum, but they're a fun group, to work with. And we were doing a turkey challenge, and it was right before Thanksgiving. And it's just one of those things, we changed up the workout, put a different name to it. You know, we named how many drumsticks and how many scoops of mashed potatoes, but obviously it was like, okay, how many medicine ball scoop tosses, you know, stuff like that. We made it fun for them, and they took it a whole step further. Now, this is after the workout, so not all of them are actually donning the outfits that they walked in, but it's just one of those things, you know? These girls are having, they're enjoying themselves. They're enjoying working out and understanding what it takes to be better on the field by focusing and committing themselves off the field. And then this last picture all the way to the right is a dancer that I coached. And we set up booths and tents at local high school football games, and it just so happened that I was training her brothers too and found out that she was in the homecoming court as a senior. And again, it's one of those things where you get to see these kids in their niche, in their environment, and still making an impact on them, still making a difference in their lives outside of the weight room, getting to know what they love to do, what they're involved with. The last pillar that I talk about is legacy. Excuse me. Before I get into explaining to why those pictures are up there, I'm going to go through an activity or a lesson, however you want to take it. That I did with a couple of my teams at Rutgers. Now, if you do not have very mature athletes, I do not suggest to do this with them. It's a little daunting, they have to be mature. But a couple of my teams, I did a legacy activity with them, and I took them to a graveyard. And we show up, and of course they have no idea why they're there. Like, Coach, what's happening? They can get a little nervous. But I'm like, all right, I want you guys, and it's emotional, so again, your kids have got to be mature in order to do this. But we take them and I say, okay, you have 5 to 10 minutes. Go walk around, look at the graves. Be very observant with what's around them, what's written on them. Take your time. Take your time. So after 5-10 minutes, call them back in. And we sit there and we go around the group and we discuss, you know, what was written, what was around the graves. And kids are going to come back and say, you know, World War II vet, beloved father, you know, best mom in the world. Some graves are going to talk about how they had beautiful flower arrangements around them. But there's going to be those other graves. There's going to be the graves with the dead flowers. There's going to be the graves that are unkept, that might just have a date on them. And what you want to teach these athletes is, if you were to die tomorrow, what's the legacy that you would leave behind? What would be written on your grave? Would someone visit it every day? Would someone actually bring flower arrangements and swap them out on a weekly basis? Again, you have to have a mature group of kids to do this with. But the power and the lesson that's behind that is tremendous. I'm sure there's other ways that you can teach legacy, but that just so happened to be the one that I chose with a couple of my smaller groups of athletes. I think if you're in football, your sport coaches can do this with their units. You know, sometimes if you're having a compliance issue, this is a great lesson to do. But anyway, so I want to go ahead and talk about my legacy. Obviously, I'm the legacy of my strength coach, and I want to talk about some
up that I coach and now are doing big things in their lives. So all the way to the left, I had a former student athlete. She played soccer for 2 years at Rutgers, and she ended up transferring down to Kennesaw State, which just so happens to be 10 minutes down the road to where I moved to. So I got to coach her for 2 years at Rutgers, and she had a ton of injuries, and she wound up going to Kennesaw State, but the best thing about it is that I can still be there for her. I take her out to lunch here and there, do kind of life talks, all that kind of stuff. And she got to finish out after 4 years. It was great to watch her finally graduate and play her last season. But she ended up interning for us at our Play Hard facility. And I tell you, she was one of the best interns that we've ever had. So she did a short internship with us after her season in the winter. And it's just one of those things where, you know, what I have instilled in her and what our staff has instilled with her, I have no doubt that she's going to do great things in the future. The next girl, she's in here for sure. I mean, they're all in here. But this girl showed up. She transferred in. I coached her. She was a golf player at Rutgers. And she showed up, transferred in as a sophomore or a junior. This girl had never been in the weight room before. She'd never been in the weight room before. She couldn't even hold a plank for more than 15 seconds. And this is, we all have athletes like that. We all have athletes. If you don't have athletes like that, I challenge you to find a facility to go coach or try to learn from athletes like that. It humbles you. It humbles you. But this girl, again, she defeated herself. Zero confidence. And it was all about her mentality. And we worked with her. 2 years went by. She graduated. She did great for the team. She got stronger in the weight room. But it was one day I was sitting in my office, and the weight room door swing open. And this person walks in with this swag. And I'm trying to figure out who it was. And all of a sudden, this woman walks into my office. And lo and behold, it was this athlete. And she's working for the PGA. She's doing all logistics for all the tournaments. And she's coaching. She's coaching younger athletes. And I am floored that this girl, who used to bawl her eyes out in every single training session, is standing in front of me talking about how she puts helicopter parents in their place on a day-to-day basis. And you're just what? Where did this come from? Again, it makes me excited to show up every day and make an impact on these kids. The two, the mean mommy guy on the bottom, he was an athlete that I coached back at Stony Brook University. He was a baseball kid. He then became an intern for us, and now he is the director of football strength and conditioning at our alma mater. So just one of those things where you look back and you're just oh my gosh, my baby has grown up. This is that kid for me. Because I saw him as an immature, non-compliant 17-year-old college athlete, and now he is running all of football strength and conditioning at our alma mater, and it's just really cool to see him and how he's grown up. And then the last guy to the right, we were undergrad together for a year. Then I started interning in the weight room. I got a job out of college, came back. I coached him for 2 years, GA. He then became our intern in the weight room. And him and I were actually supposed to get a second degree with him. I ended up getting the full-time job at Rutgers, but he went on to be an assistant for at Toledo, the Jets, and now he's at Iowa State as one of their assistant football strength coaches. So it's just one of those things where, think about your legacy. Think about the people that are going to carry your name on, that are going to carry your principles and your coaching philosophy on. Well, how are you making an impact on those kids' lives on a day-to-day basis? With that being said, that's all I have for you guys today. All my information's up there. I'll be around for the whole day, so if you guys have any further questions about what we do, I also wanted to let you know that you are a younger strength coach or maybe you're looking for something new on the horizon, we're actually, we are working with the Chinese Olympic Committee and we're currently coaching their, the Chinese Olympic rowing team. And we're also going to be taking on all of their tactical sports and the Olympic weightlifting. So we have about 25 coaches in China right now. So if that's an opportunity that you're interested in, please come and see me. Again, I'll be here all day.